What's up, Madden 17 fans? My name is Cody, and I want to welcome you to our video today. Real quick, I just want to make one suggestion to everyone before we get started is, guys, the only way that I can help is by you asking questions. That's really the only way that I think I'm actually going to be able to help anyone get better. And so what I would really like you guys to do is just comment. What questions do you have? And if I can't answer it in a reply in the comment section, I'll do a whole video based on exactly your question. So and real quick, guys, let me just say this. I truly believe this. You're only going to get better if you ask better questions. I can give you the how-to, I can give you the tips, I can give you the on paper plan for how to get better overnight, but at the end of the day, it's really going to come down to, can you ask the right questions? And more importantly, can you do something with the answers? And I really think that those are the two keys to really becoming good at anything, not just Madden, but anything in life. So anyways, real quick, guys, also, if you could hit that subscribe button, that would be awesome. Trying to get the channel back up and growing. So subscribe if what you see today is helpful, is useful. I think it will be. So what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be doing a couple things. So we're just going to be playing a standard game, and I want to share some of my tips, tricks, strategies as we go through it, because I'm actually getting to the level now where I'm starting to play a lot of competitive, a lot more of a competitive competition. You're seeing a couple of things as I kind of get up the salary cap trying to qualify here for some of the Madden tournaments. You're seeing a couple things. Number one, you're seeing cover two blitz, as we all expected. But I think what's also interesting is you're seeing a lot better pressure. So as you kind of rank up, you start to get better blitzes. That's really the one thing. If there's anything that changes when you rank up the corporate, when you rank up the ladder in the leaderboards, I believe that it is the quality of opponent, especially the quality of pressure that you're going to see. So this guy is going to probably largely run nickel blitz too. And that's what most people have been running. It's either nickel blitz two, DB fire two press from the $326. Outside of that, I'm not getting a whole lot different. That's pretty much it. I haven't seen a whole lot of different strategies, but really it all kind of revolves around the same kind of concept, and that is to basically run a cover two zone blitz, use the cover two sink flat zones, which are what's called soft squats. And that's really what you see. I mean, if you really boil it down to one defensive play, that's pretty much what I've seen across all platforms of the game, no matter what, whether it's competitive or as I'm just playing here in the ranked leaderboards. So you know, I think this is going to help you guys from an offensive standpoint see that you can still execute your offense even against pressure. It's just about getting your reads down. I mean, it really is simple. It really is, but I'm telling you guys, it really comes down to can you get your reads down. And can you execute? It's really, again, it's that simple. Oh crap, almost threw a pick there. Got kind of bailed out. I was trying to hit triangle and I bumped. I think I bumped the wrong button. Or I was supposed to throw it to Benjamin, but I just didn't. It was my fault. Got a little caught up. So real quick, another reason, a question I think that is important to answer. So some people may ask me this question, why do you only run two plays? Like, that's lame. And I want to tell you, most of you have probably heard why, but I want to kind of talk about it just briefly for those guys that are new to the channel. It's a couple reasons. The first one is it's a controllable variable. In my opinion, you can only control certain things within a game. You can control what you do. And what happens is people don't realize that when you control what you control, which is your play selection, it somewhat dictates what the defense is going to have to do. For example, he's not going to be able to run cover two blitz all game off that left side. Otherwise, this is going to happen over and over again. I'm going to be able to work the ball up and down the field. He's going to have to do something to stop my power play. Once he stops my power play, I need to have a play that I would call a counter play. So I kind of live by this philosophy that there's only two types of plays that you're going to run. You're either going to run a power play or you're going to run a counter play. And you can actually have multiple power plays, multiple counter plays, but in my opinion, I really subscribe to this. This is something I read in a book earlier. I think the author of this has a really, really good point. He talks about what is the minimal effective dose? And what he means by that is, what is basically the smallest thing that you can do to elicit what you want to have happen? And I think he's making a really good point, especially as it applies to the playbook and things like that, because what most people try to do is most people try to have the biggest, thickest playbook possible. But when you really break down the better players in Madden, they really have probably 2 to 5 plays that they really, really run a lot. And so I try to kind of emulate that. I think they're onto something, even if they don't know that they're onto something. And I think it's not just a Madden thing. I think it's definitely something that can really impact the way that people play in the NFL. If you really, really think about it, again, you master just a couple of little bitty things. Again, I'm very, very, very passionate about simplifying your playbook. Okay, and I really believe in it. I think there's only two real types of plays, because what happens is when you go to a new formation, when you go to say for example, wow, I think he just roasted my cover two. Nice play. Do we get him down? When you go to a different type of formation, it tells me a couple things. Number one, you are going to probably run what everybody else is going to run. I mean, I haven't seen a whole lot of innovation that I'm not really anticipating, okay? So that's number one. Number two, and I think more importantly, when you go, the psychological factor starts to kick in, okay? And I do a lot of things. When you realize that a lot of people, what they do is they adjust to what the opponent is doing, so they will adjust to what I do. So to stop PA posts, they will do a couple of things to stop that play specifically. What happens is, then if I go to another play, that play needs to be a very, very good counterpart to that play. But here's the problem. If I only run PA post once, and then I run verticals once, and then I run Z spot once, and then I run halfback screen once, and I do that for 4 plays, I'm going to get probably, more than likely, they're not going to even try to adjust to what I'm running. And if they don't try to adjust to what I'm running, then I'm not going to have any time opportunity for big plays. You're just going to see little bitty checkdowns over and over again. And it's going to be this game of cat and mouse, and they're just going to play Tampa 2 over top all game long because they have no idea of how to gamble. What I want to do is I want to force the defense to have to gamble for a couple reasons. The first reason, I think it's going to allow my offense to make some really big plays. And if I trust myself as a quarterback, I know that I'll be able to read these plays. And then second, another reason that I want the defense to have to gamble is because it puts them in a very awkward position. It gets them out of what they want to do. Most people, what they really want to do if they're you know, shooting straight, they want to sit in their cover two blitz all game long. They don't want to have to get out of that. What I'm hoping to accomplish by doing this is it forces you to have to adapt and adjust. Whereas if I just ran 4 plays or 4 different plays in 4 situations, what's going to happen is they're never going to have to adjust, right? They're just going to have to sit in their playbook. I don't know. It makes sense to me. What do you guys think? Let me know. I'm interested to hear your guys' takes on it. I'm just telling you, I've just seen it over and over again. People try to run too much. People try to do way too much, and normally that's the issue with why they're not successful. Is because they're trying to do a little too much right there. See, that's one of those situations we'll do a little something different. A lot of it right there was just because of the look he was giving me. And occasionally you can do that. Those are called constraint theory plays. And what they're really designed to do is take advantage of very specific, definitive looks that the defense might give you. And see there, so he starts overplaying. He'll start overplaying certain things, but I want him to still see the same routes so that he'll overplay them, but I have other reads. And that's kind of the key to the whole thing. But again, I won't bore you with that. I've talked about that quite a bit and quite at length. So, but I am interested to hear what you guys think. Do you think it's a good strategy, or would you do something different? Let me know in the comments. Let's see here. Eli Manning just got shamed. One other thing I want to share with you guys real quick, I think this is really important, I think this will really help you a lot, is I believe that things are not exactly, things really come down to execution. Can you execute? Can you execute your game plan? If you can execute your game plan, you're going to be doing great. If you can't execute your game plan, like right there, that's something I can't control. He fumbled the ball, it's no big deal. So I got to let it go. But also, if you can't execute your game plan, so you can have 45,000 plays, but if you can't run them and you can't run them under pressure specifically, you're going to have a hard time. Okay, it comes down to can you execute under pressure, under the toughest circumstances? Can you do it? Can you execute? That needs to be an interception. Thank you. Everybody knew he was going back to that read. But yeah, again, and it's little bitty things. It's little bitty tweaks here and there. Most people don't realize the subtlety of adjustments that you will see throughout a game. But I'm guaranteeing you, if you really watch, there's very subtle adjustments that people will do with their user player, what they'll do with cross man techniques. Like right there, I don't know, that's kind of a finicky little sack. I've never really seen that blitz. That's probably a fluke. And that will happen from time to time in games. A fluke of a fumble or a snap situation where maybe he gets pressure and he probably shouldn't have. Stuff like that does happen, especially when you're facing stuff like the nickel blitz too. Wow, that was a really good play by him. That's a terrible read by me. I don't know what I was thinking. So I made a couple mistakes. See, it goes back to execution. So now I'm at a two turnover situation. Now he's got a really good opportunity here to go downfield and score. He should start with a run here if he's smart. He doesn't. No. And he overthrows him. Got lucky there. So he's going to run. He's going to kind of keep running this. Got a little caught up there. There we go. Not too bad. Not too bad. So third and 10. Defensively, why do I stay in Tampa 2 so much? Well, a couple reasons. Number one, I think it's the best coverage that you can have. Why do I play 4-3 under? It's the coverage I think that it really does the best job, in my opinion, for multiple reasons. 4-3 under, what it does, I think, is it gives you the opportunity to be able to really stop the run effectively in different situations, I think, also. Number two, it has some interesting different pressures you can run, some passive pressures, some things that, in my opinion, I think they're really good for, I think they're really good to have in your back pocket. One reason that maybe I should stick with the nickel blitz is nickel blitz does get probably better pressure in the big picture of things. It probably does get better pressure. But I trust what I'm doing here with this. And I go to the nickel blitz in certain situations. There's a couple reasons why. Why would I go to nickel normal instead of $3-2-6 when I'm in a situation where I want to stop the pass? That's a good question. Some people will probably be asking like that. There's twofold reasons. So number one, I believe the same philosophy applies to defense that applies to offense. So that's why I only run one formation. Man, what in the world is going on? They like patched... they did some kind of interesting thing where they patched your line. And so if you have a really bad line, you're supposed to start feeling like effects. In my opinion, that's an interesting little deal, because how are you going to really manage that to where, I don't know. This is going to be interesting to see. Like right there, how does that happen? Like he blitzes, so stupid. I go max protect, which is crazy to me. Make a catch, Marshall. Right there, I'm just kind of trying to get out of here and get out of here with a one possession lead, because that was a couple bad sacks there. I don't know about that. I think that's going to be an issue with this new patch. I just saw that it came out, some updates they did, and you know, be quite frank with everybody here, I don't know what that's going to entail, because I don't have a great offensive line by any stretch of the imagination, just like everybody else that plays Mutt salary cap. Because of the way the game is played, you have to make decisions, and I made that decision to basically my decision was, come on, I'm having a lot of trouble here with my user. My decision was to not get good offensive linemen so that I could use my cap in other positions, and I think that's probably the majority of people. apparently it looks like they're going to try to punish you for that by having this new situation where if your offensive line sucks, they're going to be very ineffective. And so far in this game, I've seen a couple of situations that I don't think really is fair. Like gap blitzes just coming in untouched. Like that's just kind of unreal. Like I just want him to put at least a hand on him. But so far, they haven't really done that. Let's see what they do here. Gosh dang it. He's in man coverage on him. PA wide receiver in. Of all plays. This guy's running some weird routes. Wow. Nice. 4 of 10. Interesting. I get a little frustrated sometimes. I don't even know what he's running here. I want that. Dang. Interesting offense he's got. Let's see what he does here. That's me. Take it back for 6. Oh, give me a better animation. Come on. That's all right. So we switched up there. So that's another thing real quick. I want to talk about that. So in play calling, what you want to do is you want to kind of time your cover threes. Or like for me, what I would call your counter plays, whether it's a cover 3 or a cover 4 or a cover 6 or a cover 12 or whatever coverage it is, you want to time it so that you only go to it in key situations. Because what's going to happen is over the more you play, the more you're going to realize that that you don't need to go to it too much. You need to go to it in certain situations. So like right there, he had been seeing that cover 3. He had been seeing it. And we just kind of said, okay, we're going to throw it at him and kind of see how he handles it, because he's become very comfortable in beating that cover 2. So then we just make that quick little adjustment, and we're able to get a good turnover there on a really tight situation where he was driving. So I think that's a pretty decent play call. Good catch, Brandon Marshall. Needed that one. We have a couple of constraint theory plays that I would call them. But again, there's very, very critical situations at which we go to them. And very specific things we look for. Wow, the tight end was... Oh, my gosh. That's so frustrating. I put the tight end on a drag route, and for some reason, he just didn't go on said drag route. Showing pressure off that left side. That was pretty bad. It's all right. 3rd and 21 here, just another day at the office. Let's see if we can't protect the quarterback. So right here, this is an interesting situation for you guys, I think, to kind of learn from. So 4th and 10. I kind of knew what he was going to run. I knew he was going to go to that nickel blitz too. I knew that I was going to be in a situation where I didn't have the real ability to pick up the first down. Here what we're going to do, a little unique. This is another setup. Oh, I didn't need to throw it away. Dang it. Terrible execution. Freaking runs a stupid nickel blitz like everybody else. Know exactly what he's going to run, and we just don't execute. So let's see what he does here. So now we're kind of in a cat and mouse game. I've stopped his major play. He's done a couple of things. See, there's that ineffective line. I mean, and it's gonna be a pain in the neck because I still have like 6 games left on this streak here to have to get through. One thing I think a lot of people make the mistake of is not realizing that, again, it's all about your mistakes. Like, if you can not make mistakes, that's me. So, like, he's made a couple of really bad mistakes. Like, he's missed a kick. I think I've got 3 or 4 interceptions. My offense has not been playing very well. Like, we've had a hard time, I think, getting the ball rolling. But what we have been able to do is somewhat limit our mistakes, okay? And we've had one turnover as far as an interception, which is not terrible. In my opinion, I want to have 0 turnovers every game. Can't necessarily always have that, but I think that's really the big difference in this game. I mean, and also the missed kick is huge. Wow, fumble. My lineman's gonna get me in field goal range. That's hilarious. We're having a really tough time though moving the ball with this new offensive line stuff. Try something here. This is a constraint theory play we go to in really critical situations. Dang it. Kind of have to take a field goal here. Really sloppy game. But, again, I think it's like who makes the more mistakes. We've made several. I think I haven't really... I'm trying to think of how to explain what I would... kind of what you guys can kind of learn from my mistakes here. I have not done a good job of sticking with my game plan. I think I've tried to, and that's what happens, is you get in this kind of mode where you're always trying to make the big play instead of the right play. Sometimes the right play is to check it down. I mean, oftentimes, actually, the right play is to check it down. There we go. We got him that time. So kind of knew what he was doing there. He's done it several times. Little sack fumble. That's just luck. I mean, he got a fumble, I got a fumble. Nothing too overtly strategic. I did blitz, you know, so I pick and choose my spots. Most people that watch me would say that I don't blitz very much. And they're right, I don't. Couple reasons. I think that pressure is oftentimes a little bit easier to come by than just blitzing. A lot of times the moment will dictate that. But sometimes there are times where I try to blitz probably a couple times a game. Different situations. It's always situational. Kind of off of tendency and what I'm trying to do, what I'm trying to take away also. So like right there, that specific blitz setup and play that I ran, it takes away everything quick. It forces him to hesitate and not have a thing. Oh no, I just freaking pulled my game out. Dang it, that's unfortunate. So I'm going to lose this game because I bumped the button with my hand. Oh man, that kind of sucks. Oh well, that's all right. But hey guys, again... kind of a takeaway from today's video is really this. Limit mistakes. Figure out however you want to do that. Find out the simplest way to play the game so that you make the least amount of mistakes. My opinion, when you try to make the game too complex, oftentimes you make it harder on yourself. So that's kind of my tip to you. Keep it simple. And we'll get back with you guys another time. Hopefully next time I'll be able to get